Thank you very much, Sri Radha. At the outset, let me apologize for my mess up in trying to get there and get to this venue on time. Syria has been a long-standing passion for me, apart from having been posted there from 1992 to 1996. I actually visited Syria in 2011 when this whole Arab Springs came to Syria. Then I visited in 2012, I visited in 2017, and I visited in 2019, which was in May of last year. So it's fairly a regular contact I've had with people in Syria, including the diplomatic advisor to President Assad, who's an old friend from my days there in 1992. So this book has been germinating in my mind for a long time, and finally it's seen the light of day. let me start by saying that it is 10 years since the Syrian conflict is going on. The Syrian conflict is quite unique in terms of what we see. The first thing is that in Syria, you have a situation where 4 out of the 5 permanent members of the Security Council are on the ground, that is, excepting China. Then all the major regional powers are there, starting with Saudi Arabia, Iran, Qatar, Turkey, and UAE, and a few others. So there are about 8 countries constantly involved with Syria all the time. And what it has actually done is, by the way, should I now unmute it? Or do I keep it on mute?
No, we can hear you. So you're unmuted. We can hear you, no problem. Just go ahead.
Okay. So, and you can see me as well, right?
Yes, perfectly.
Okay, fine. So the first point I'd like to make is that the Syrian civil war is probably a precursor of what we will see in the future. You have an interstate and an intrastate war taking place in the same time and space. We may not have a world war, but we may have some such thing happening. Because it suits everyone to bring all their problems in one place. Syria actually, even traditionally and historically, has been known to actually provide the ground, the battleground, if one can say, for opposing ideas, ideologies, and views to contest. This has happened with Syria all across its history. And now we see it happening here, and it's now in its 10th year. So the two main sort of characteristics of this, what's going on there, is first, of course, the global implications of the fact that all the major international powers, let's say world powers, P4 out of the P5, are there, which explains to you why there has never ever been an attempt to bring any kind of a peace to this country. Only once, actually only twice, that the United Nations Security Council came to a conclusion. One was eventually when they passed resolution 2254 in 2015, which has provided the blueprint of how peace can be initiated and ensured in Syria. The second is when it came to the question of the removal of the chemical weapons that the Syrian President Bashar Assad had, which were actually successfully removed by 2016. Nevertheless, everybody there is using chemical weapons even today. So that is one whole aspect of how all these countries which have put their foot in Syria, backing at a certain time in these last 10 years, there were 1,000 small radical Islamic groups fighting with Assad, all of them backed by different countries, which I've just named. And this has been going on. So it's quite remarkable that in spite of that, President Assad has been able to get back 90% of his country and almost 75% of his population. What remains are the two provinces of Idlib and Afrin, which are on the border of Turkey. And of course, now we find a new war, a new small war starting there between the Turks and the Syrians. Why was Assad able to do this? I'll come to that. But before that, I'll also say that what is happening in Syria, apart from the overthrow or complete disregard of basic UN principles which were taken as cardinal, for example, non-intervention, for example, respecting the sovereignty of every country, the use of self-defense, either in an individual country's case or as a group, in the only way it can be done is when there's a UN Security Council resolution. None of these countries, except Russia and Iran, are in Syria without even as a buy or leave from anybody. Only Russia and China have been, Russia and Iran have been there. Iran went there in 2013. And when Iran went, obviously, you had the Hezbollah there as well. It was, in that sense, a payback time for them because the Syrians had been consistently supporting the movement of arms and other things to the Hezbollah. Russia went there in 2015, and Russian entry made a tremendous change and, in fact, was responsible and still remains responsible for Assad getting back most of his country. So that is one set, but remember that what has been lost are the basic cardinal principles of the United Nations. And this at a time when we all say that the international system is in a churn. It is a system which is in the making or the remaking. And where will it all end? And how will the new system go ahead? Syria, in that sense, will have a major impact on how can you expect the new system to succeed. Mainly because if the UN Security Council, which is completely hemmed in by self-serving interests, what do you expect to happen? The second part of the war, second dimension of the war, is that you have actually both on the ground and ideologically a battle going on between or within Islam, between the Shias and the Sunnis. Because unlike in Iraq, where you had a small Sunni coterie running Iraq for 40 years under Saddam Hussein, and that was corrected thanks to the American invasion. In Syria, it's exactly the opposite. It is a small coterie of Alawites who are Shia controlling the country, running the country. The Assad family actually has been there for 40 years, but the majority is Sunni. So that struggle is going on, and you can see its manifestation on the ground between both when you see the way Saudi Arabia and Iran have acted in Iran, in Syria and continue to do so. So these are the two. So it is both a battleground for opposing interests. There is a hybrid religious war going on, and there is an overthrow of every international principle that we have held dear ever since the Second World War ended. So you can well imagine that Syria has probably not widely known, but Syria will have and has had a major impact on how the international system has performed so far. The most immediate and visual impact of the Syrian crisis is the refugee and the displaced. Nearly 11 million out of the Syria's 22 million have been displaced one way or the other. 11 million, have been displaced, and 6 million have been displaced, and 5.5 million are refugees all over the place, but mainly in Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon. I had actually the opportunity to visit the camps that they have set up in Jordan for the Syrian refugees. And it is quite amazing, the ones I interviewed, and that's all that's in the book, the interviews are there in the book, that they have, they all want to go back, but all of them are very conscious. They said, we don't want other people, other countries to interfere in our country. Let us handle our own situation as we think it. So that the refugee impact, and the refugee impact as far as Europe is concerned, because most of them are poised to enter Europe. But with it, you have had, with them, I mean, we have had an element of the ISIS, remnants of the ISIS, who have managed to smuggle in, who have been responsible for terrorist attack in UK, in France, in Netherlands. So that has again colored the view as far as the Syrian refugees is concerned. But they are there. And how are they going to get back? That is the issue that concerns us. Firstly, the cost. It is estimated that between about 465,000 people have been killed in the last 10 years, or last 8 years. The United Nations has even stopped counting how many have been killed. 1 million have been injured. Now, rehabilitation of the entire country, because whole country except Damascus is devastated. And it's going to require anywhere between 250 billion to 350 billion. Where is that money going to come from? All these questions still remain. So you have a very interesting state of play at the moment. While Assad controls, as I said, 90% of the country, and he's trying to start some rehabilitation projects. On the one hand, he's finding money, and in fact, the Russian role has been quite important in this. The problem here is that it is what we call victor's justice. We have seen it in Sri Lanka, we've seen it in Iraq, and I fear that it may happen in Syria as well, because once the leader wins, then the amenability to actually coming to what needs to be done, which is to set up some kind of a democratic system which gives voice to the Syrian people, may not happen or will be very difficult to achieve. So this is a problem that faces or has continued to face the United Nations, which has been trying since 2012 to find some kind of peace. Till today, in spite of UN forums in Geneva, in Vienna, and in Astana, there has not been an agreement on having a simple thing like a durable ceasefire. Because unless there is a durable ceasefire, you're not going to get anywhere beyond trying to set up what can be done to improve the lot of the Syrians. Of course, to that, we have to add the fact that now that there is basically a kind of I don't know that one can call it border war, but Turkey hasn't got it yet, but it's trying to have a small strip in Syria. Its army is there. And Erdogan says that he wants to resettle 2 million of the 3.5 million who are in Turkey. Whether he does it or not is not a matter, but he has also said in a sort of, people have called it neo-Ottomanism, that he would like to have a hand in the decision as far as Syria is concerned in the future also. Now, whether that will happen or not is a question that needs to be asked. The multidisciplinary conflict that we see taking place in Syria has been also characterized by a few other things. But first, before I get there, let me say, how has Assad been able to survive so many years? I mean, of course, the Russian help and the Iranian help was important. But he has also had to do a lot of things, because if you compare it with the situation in Iraq and the situation probably now in Afghanistan, there hasn't been the same leader going on all these years. So, and what Assad inherited, I mean, what Bashar Assad inherited from his father, Hafez Assad, was an efficient state structure. We may not agree with the kind of state structure, but it was an efficient structure. It took care of incomes, it took care of education, it took care of health. The second thing was that Hafez Assad himself depoliticized his army, because he realized that this will be an important factor. Then Assad has had or has shown a clear ability to outplay his regional and international enemies. And he has been able to exploit ethnic and sectarian fault lines in all among within all his neighbors to his own advantage. So he has with great acumen actually been able to do this. But in doing so and accepting Russian and Iranian help, Iranian including Hezbollah, of course, what Assad has or may have lost is the ability to take independent decisions as we move forward, because he will be perpetually in hock to up to a point to both these countries. What does Russia gain out of it? The ability to show that they still matter in the Middle East, but also to shore up in Syria, with which they have had a long-standing relationship. But also more importantly, they now have a port, the only port they've ever had in the Mediterranean, which is Tartus. And they have now got an air base at Hamayn. Apart from that, all this, they believe, has taken the world's mind off Ukraine and Crimea. So there are clear advantages why Russia remains there. For Iran, the main thing is, as I said, it's payback time for all the help that that they got from Assad. They are repaying that debt. But more importantly, Iran would like to have some kind of a permanent presence on the side of the Golan opposite Israel. And therefore, Israel, as you know, for them, the number one enemy is Iran. Israel is now involved also in Syria, because it is bombing Syrian Iranian sites in order to, and they have made it clear that they will not allow Iran to stay permanently in Syria or have any bases. It is all being controlled, surprisingly, by Russia, which has been able to play all these people and get a voice for itself with all players in Syria. So what about the democracy and the democracy movement and all that was started with the Arab Spring? It was started, of course, and it came to Syria in 2011 and in a place called Daraa. Daraa, before that, was only known because Lawrence of Arabia, there's a statue to him in Daraa. That is where he had rallied the Arab troops. Turkish troops. Now, there what happened was that it started with a completely non-violent protest, starting with school children, but the Syrian governor of Daraa came down very hard on the students, totally unnecessary, but in so doing, he caused a reaction, and that reaction spread all across the country in no time. It also, in a way, negated the fact that the people who were, and this is true in many other Arab countries, that the reason why the Arab Spring, so-called, failed was because the people who were protesting did not have a clear agenda, did not have a clear leader, and did not know how did they want to go ahead. But at the same, so that is why you find one by one most of these Arab Spring episodes expired. But it revived again in 2019 in Algeria and Sudan, and mainly because this last decade was a completely lost decade for the Arab world. There nothing at all happened. Tourism, whatever such as it was went down, incomes went down, and population went up. So you had a very difficult situation created by these conditions on top of the perpetual case of how do we get a voice in decision making in these countries. So this is how the things have not worked. The other important thing I'd like to mention is that in spite of that, as I mentioned earlier, the only time when the United Nations, second time that the United Nations was successful, Security Council, was in getting Syria to give up its chemical weapons. And by 2016, the OPCW had been able to remove all Syrian stockpiles. Now, why did Syria have these stockpiles of chemical weapons? Mainly as the only thing that they could have to combat Israel. The couple of times that they tried to set up a nuclear facility, it was bombed by Israel. So they said they would do it with chemical weapons. The Russians persuaded them that if you give up chemical weapons, Assad could be assured a longevity of his own life, which was true, that without Assad and with all these terrorist groups there, it could not be possible that they would get rid of any chemical weapon. So that's how it was done. But chemical weapons have continued to be used all through these 10 years. Around 336 separate incidents have been recorded. Now, the position of the United States has been both under Obama and Trump very ambivalent. They're not really interested in getting involved in Syria, because they come to the conclusion that we don't have any vital interest involved, except two. One was the ISIS, and second was the chemical weapons. Now, Trump has, of course, declared that he has won against ISIS and decided that he's going to go out. The ISIS actually has been more or less decimated on the ground, and they have gone back. They have not been able to hold any territory like they did in Raqqa and other parts of Syria. They have gone back to their old missionary activity. There are still about 3,000 ISIS around Deir ez-Zor, which is on the border of Iraq and Syria. So the ISIS has not been completely wiped out. It will remain. Whether it grows or not is really an issue that needs to be discussed. And it has not happened so far by the Organization of Islamic States, because it is, by its mandate, in a position to get all the Islamic countries together to decide what should be done. Because whether we like it or not, what ISIS preaches or professes is a very extreme form of Islam, but nevertheless, it is there. So how do you minimize it? That is a major problem, I think, which will face the OIC and others. Now, as far as... I think I'm taking too much time, but...
Maybe another 5 minutes, is that all right?
Yeah, I'll just quickly tell you in 5 minutes that the UN Resolution 2254 of 15 is a very comprehensive document which has been accepted by most countries. And it has, from 2012, slowly they have been negotiating on every little bit of that resolution in order to find a way in which a viable governance can be established in Syria, a way in which Assad, maybe his staying there, can be bartered or traded against finance for reconstruction of Syria. So there are a number of these issues. How are the people who are missing and in custody to be released? There are at least 10 different issues that need to be immediately tackled. This all apart from rebuilding the entire country. All of Aleppo is more or less wiped out. Many other cities are. Only Damascus, which I can say till May last year, was perfectly fine. But it has taken a huge burden to keep Damascus going. Russia, I believe, is the best placed to do this within the UN Security Council. And I had the opportunity to talk about this to somebody called Yakunin, who heads the Rhodes Forum and is very close to Putin, but whether they'll do something or not, do I did see that something happened. What do you do? I think the Treaty of Guarantee on Cyprus, which is guaranteed by Cyprus, Greece, Turkey, and the UK, provides a good model to do a similar thing where all Security Council members provide a guarantee for Syria, this thing. What should be the contents of such changes? I won't come into it unless somebody asks on me. So let me stop here.